our worship service here for December the 19th, Sunday morning, here at First Baptist Church of Holdo, Mississippi. It's a wonderful day to be in the house of the Lord. Let me go over our announcements very quickly. We will not have evening services tonight or on December the 26th. Families are gathering, having their Christmas celebrations, so we will be having only Sunday morning services today and on December 26th. On Tuesday, the 21st, our young at heart are going Christmas caroling. They are to meet at the Family Life Center at 5 o'clock, and I know that they're looking for a great time of Christmas carol fellowship. December the 22nd, our Kid Time Christmas program is at 6 o'clock. There will be refreshments afterwards, and there is a sign-up sheet in the foyer right by the water fountain, in the hall, right by the water fountains. The Kid Time Christmas program will be at 6 o'clock on Wednesday night. And I think the kids have, somebody can wave at me and tell me if I'm wrong, I think the kids have practice right after the service today. So I think our Kid Time kids will be doing that today. December 22nd, that Wednesday night, our adults and youth will not meet because, of course, we will be here in the sanctuary supporting our children with their Christmas program. December 25th is Saturday. Merry Christmas to everyone that day, and I hope you all enjoy fellowshipping around your family, with your family, and things like that. Our Lottie Moon Christmas offering for international missions, you will notice that we have a goal of $2,000. Given so far has been $1,460, so we are about $500 away from meeting our goal. And also don't forget about our weekly needs. Our offering plates are down front on the front pew, and they're in the foyer. If you are joining us via Facebook Live, or you're watching the recast on YouTube, you may send in your offerings to P.O. Box 205, or you can drop them by the church here at 504 Griffin Avenue. The flowers that you see in our church this morning were given by Tana and Fred Coleman, their family, for Christmas, and they are beautiful. We certainly appreciate those flowers to be here. And let's bow for a word of prayer for this morning. Lord, we just ask you to be with us today. Help us understand the true meaning of Christmas, Lord. And Lord, help us to be able to celebrate Christmas the way that you would have us do so. And Lord, we just give you the praise and the honor and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Mr. Mike, is the video up? We have a Lottie Moon video, I hope. Don't know if we have any audio. I know. Red button on the computer. Okay, maybe we don't have any audio. This is showing us one of the many places that our International Missions Board offering goes.
Together, began to study unreached people groups, ended up going to the places we go in North Africa. If you walked out the door and you said, I want to go find a Christian today, you would have to meet 33,000 people plus before you would meet a Christian. And I climbed up on the wall, and it was this humongous cemetery, and I thought to myself, 0.01% of people in that cemetery is in heaven today. I came back and I showed that picture to my church. I said, church, we've got to go. Henderson had not even taken an actual mission trip. So we put a team together, began to study the unreached people groups, ended up going to Europe where there are 500,000 North Africans following the Savior. And he took us to the church that we partner with now, and they were already reaching out to Muslims, and they made us better. We were able to open our first school in North Africa to see people come to faith, disciple them, and to see church planted.
Nations could be reached within our lifetime, and so that became really exciting for us to be part of that, and we kept making trip after trip after trip.
My eyes were completely open. This is what heaven will look like. Languages, cultures.
For us to be obedient, that means we can go, we can actually go and do it.
We have a pastor from the Middle East. His services are being watched literally all over the world. He has seen people come to faith all the time. The Great Commission says, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you to do. Being obedient, it's hard, it's difficult, has propelled us to the ends of the earth.
If our choir will make their way to their places, we are about to do our call to worship and Advent reading with our choir.
The fourth candle is the candle of love. The light of this candle is meant to remind us of the love that God has for each one of us. 1 John 4:9 says, "In this the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him." Micah chapter 5 tells us, "But you, O Bethlehem of Ephrathah, who are one of the little clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to rule in Israel, whose origin is from of old, from ancient days. Therefore he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has brought forth. Then the rest of his kindred shall return to the people of Israel, and he shall stand and feed his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God, and they shall live secure. For now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be the one of peace." Mary's words in Luke 1, known as the Magnificat, tell of God's great love for us. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever.
Do we see thee, Lord?
We're about to sing, "I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day." No? Not working? Okay, we're not singing "I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day." We are having some technical difficulties this morning, and I was afraid that might happen. So we are going to go to Plan B. I know that you don't have anything in front of you to look at, but all of you know "Away in a Manger." And that's what we're going to sing. We're going to sing "Away in a Manger" and "Silent Night." All right, y'all ready? I say we are. Hang on just a second. Sometimes we have to make some changes. Try "Joy to the World." We're going to try those because I think those are ones that everybody knows. First verse. System will be back up at that time, but if it's not, we will manage. Luke chapter 2, as we get ready to look at verses 1 through 20, and there it is. And we're waiting for Mike to get to come down. As you know, for many years now, it's part of our Christmas tradition that we do the Little Drummer Boy. This began probably 10 or 15 years ago when Wilma got the idea that, hey, we ought to do this for Christmas one year. And she and Mike got it together, and I am no Wilma by any means, but I do like to do this song with Mike, and we try to do this every Christmas.
Thank you. Amen. Chapter 2 already, as we are going to be in Luke chapter 2 this morning. And I have asked Miss Martha Collins to come this morning and to recite these verses for us before I get started.
That she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. And they were in the same country, shepherds keeping watch over their flock by night. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto them, and the glory of the Lord shone all around about them, and they were sore afraid. But the angel said unto them, "Fear not, for I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." And when the angel was gone away, the shepherds said one to another, "Come, let us go see this thing which has come to pass that was spoken to us by the angel." And they came in haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they had seen him, they went away rejoicing at all the things that they had seen and heard. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart.
Amen.
That is the Christmas story, and this morning we are going to look at the topic, how to celebrate Christmas. That's what we're supposed to be doing this time of year, right, is celebrating Christmas, celebrating the birth of our Lord and Savior. And during this season, there's a lot of shopping that takes place. Many of you have worn out the UPS and FedEx drivers in recent days and weeks, as well as the Postal Service as a part of the season of shopping, and most people now turning to online shopping rather than going to the store. And so there have been numerous packages delivered and things like that going on, and there has been a lot of entertaining going on. There's already been church Christmas parties and Sunday school activities and all kinds of things like that going on. And so that is what we are entering into. It's going to be a busy time over the next several weeks. And while we're in this season of shopping and entertaining and becoming busy, we should remember why we as Christians are celebrating in the first place. We are celebrating the greatest gift that was ever given in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And in this story, this morning, we see the birth of Jesus and the coming of the Messiah, and all of these things are laid out for us. And we think about this time of year, right? We have decorated our homes. We put out the different decorations inside. We put out decorations outside. Some hang lights, some don't. Some go all out with it, kind of like Clark Griswold. Some are more like the cranks and didn't want to decorate at all this year. And so we see all of this kind of stuff going on, and there are those who still send out Christmas cards. There are some that do that digitally now. Rather than sending it through the mail, they do it through email or put it on social media. But there are the Christmas cards that are out there. Certainly during this time of year, we can visit friends. And we should spend time with friends during this time of year. And we buy presents. And this Tuesday night, the Young at Heart are going Christmas caroling. And some of you other ones may be going Christmas caroling at some point as well. Some celebrate Christmas Day differently. Some celebrate Christmas Day by watching football and basketball games, and that's all they're really concerned about. That's all they really have put their time and investment in, is just to watch some football and basketball games. For some, this time of year is where they begin to drink and party, and they'll do that this week all the way through the new year and well into the new year, because they don't know what they're celebrating. They don't really know why they are having those parties. They don't really understand the significance of what was put in words for us here in Scripture in Luke chapter 2. But this is a holiday. This is a holy day. This is a day to honor the fact that God sent His Son to be born in a manger to become our Savior. As Christians, we should celebrate in a unique way. And so this morning I want to offer four responses to the birthday of Christ based on the words that are seen here in verses 1 through 20 of Luke chapter 2. It says there in verse 1 that it came to pass in those days there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. Whenever you began to study this out, there was a time period up to this point for about 20 years. There had been civil unrest, there had been war, there had been no peace, there had been no tranquility. It was constantly conflict and turmoil. And then all of a sudden Caesar Augustus reigns supreme. He gets control, and now there's peace. It is possible maybe that Charles Dickens was thinking about this time period when he penned the words, "It was the best of times, it was the worst of times." Because there was plenty of turmoil and anxiety and conflict up to this point, but now they've entered into a time of what they thought was peace under Caesar Augustus. But what we're going to notice in these verses is that the angels declared that Caesar Augustus couldn't bring peace, that no political party or political system could bring peace, but only the Savior could bring true peace. Only the Messiah could bring true peace, because He made it possible for us to be right with God. He bridged that gap that was there. And so when we enter into a relationship with Jesus Christ, we can truly experience peace in the midst of suffering, in the midst of turmoil, in the midst of trials, in the midst of tribulation. We have peace. And so there are four responses that we notice here as we get further into these verses that we can see that will encourage us, that will challenge us on how to celebrate Christmas. One way that we can celebrate Christmas is to witness about Christ. One way you can celebrate during this time of year, during this season that we're in, is to use it as an opportunity to witness about Christ. Because we read all that took place here, how Joseph and Mary had to travel, and she was with child, and they were in this region, in this area, and because of all the people that had traveled in and all the family that was there, by the time they made it, there were no rooms left for them in the public inn, and so they were assigned to a different place in the back part. In a manger is where our Savior was born, and He was wrapped in swaddling cloth and laid down there and all those things. When you get to verse 8, we see the shepherds. Now, we've talked about this before, but it bears repeating. The shepherds were out in the dark. There were no street lights. There were no anything like that around. It was dark. They were watching over their sheep. They were probably settled in for the night. They may have even been talking about Caesar Augustus and some of the different things that had gone on since he had begun to reign and take control of the region. And as they're there, whatever was going on, it says that the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. You can imagine that it's dark. It is dark. It's still, it's probably quiet. And then all of a sudden this angel appears, and there's the bright light all around them. And so they didn't know what was happening. They didn't understand what was taking place, but the angel would explain, along with the heavenly host that appeared in the verses that follow. He said, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people." And so this is what we witness about, this great news that was told to the shepherds, which points to the fact that Jesus came to die for all, regardless of whether you are the lowest person on the totem pole or the highest authority figure that there is. Christ came to die for you. He paid your sin debt so that you could experience eternal life, so that you could be adopted into the family of God, so that you could become joint heirs with Jesus Christ. And what you begin to see here is after the shepherds hear this message and are told where this baby is at, that they can travel to Bethlehem and they will be able to find him. In verse 16, it says they came with haste. They didn't delay. They didn't offer up excuses. They didn't try to figure out who was going to go and how they were going to go or when they were going to get there. They just gathered up as quickly as possible and they set out for Bethlehem. And they get there and they experience this. They find Mary and Joseph. And they see the baby lying in the manger. Now, what do we begin to see here? We know who these shepherds were and what they were responsible for as we begin to study this out. These shepherds were responsible for the lambs that were more than likely used for the sacrifices in the temple. We know that those lambs had to be without spot, they had to be without blemish. And so what they would do when a new lamb was born was they would wrap those lambs' legs up so that they wouldn't be caught up in anything that could deform the body, that could cause these lambs to not be worthy to be sacrificed. And they look, and there is Jesus lying in a manger with these strips of cloth wrapped around his arms and his legs. A symbol to us that he would be the perfect sacrifice, the propitiation for our sin. And so we witness about Christ during this season. And they see this. The shepherds see this. They experience this. And it says in verse 17, when they saw it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. Some translations say there they made it widely known. In other words, the shepherds didn't go and they didn't see these things and they didn't experience these things and then travel back to the field and never tell anybody about it. As soon as they got outside of where Jesus and Mary and Joseph were staying, the first person they encountered, they told them about it. And the next person they encountered, they told them about it. And the next person they encountered, they told them about it. And that is what we can do during this Christmas season, and it should prepare us for doing it every time that we have an opportunity, every time that we get a chance to tell someone of Jesus and to share the gospel message, we should do it. And one way that we can celebrate Christmas is to witness about Christ. There are many opportunities available during Christmas to make Christ known to those around us. Think about it. There are multiple times to help someone understand that Christ came as our Savior. We can do it with the Christmas cards that we talked about earlier that we send out. with the Bible verses that we put on there and the displays of the pictures and different scenes in the background, it can share the story of our Savior. Even how we decorate our homes can point people to the Savior. We can have figures of baby Jesus, and we can have the manger scenes, and we can have all these things that help to point people to Christ whenever they come into our home. Even through the music we sing, the songs that we sang this morning go along with the Christmas story and point people to Jesus. They are a way for us to witness. And obviously during this time of year there are special services, and we can invite people to attend those services and give them the opportunity to hear the gospel proclaimed. There are numerous ways, there are various ways, there are different ways to make widely known what Jesus has done for us. How he was willing to leave the splendor and glory of heaven, how he was born in this way and in this place, in the right moment, at the right time, in the fullness of time, the book of Galatians tells us, Jesus was born. At the time that Jesus was born, not only had peace come in under Caesar Augustus, but we know the roads were well traveled at this time, and there were plenty of roads in and out and plenty of places to travel to. And so the word quickly began to spread, not only about the birth of Jesus, but then whenever he would begin his public ministry, he was able to travel easier, the disciples were able to travel easier, and the word continued to spread so that the disciples could witness about Christ. That's what we've been placed here to do. That's why we're still here today as individuals that make up the church. We are to be witnessing for Christ. We are to be telling people about Christ. We are to remember that we are his ambassadors, that we are his representatives in a world that needs to know that he loved them enough, that he was willing to be born in this way, to die for them. And he was buried in a borrowed tomb. He was born in a borrowed place. He was buried in a borrowed tomb. And he arose on the third day, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father, ever interceding for you and me. And so not only as we gather together as families, as churches, as friends, to celebrate Christmas, we need to remember that we can witness about Christ, but we need to wonder at Christ. We don't need to just read through these verses because it's tradition or because it's the Christmas story, but have we ever just gotten quiet and gotten still and wondered at what is said here? Thought about what is recorded here and what happened and what took place. The angels and the heavenly host, or the angel and the heavenly host, appeared to the shepherds, and they began to proclaim and to praise, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. There were people who thought that Caesar Augustus was the one that would bring peace, but ultimately Jesus is the only one that can bring peace. And it says that as the angels went away, the shepherds said to one another, let's go. And they saw these things, and they proclaimed these things. And in verse 18, it says, all they that heard it wondered at these things which were told them by the shepherds. Now, we've already pointed out before that the shepherds were not seen as reliable witnesses in that day and age. They never would have been called to testify in court. They were ceremonially unclean, so they weren't even able to go and offer sacrifices in the temple. And yet, here they were, the first ones that heard the message and that were willing to proclaim the message. And because they were willing to proclaim the message, because they were simply willing to share and make widely known what they had seen, heard, and experienced, others wondered at these things. There's a word in the English language that is not used much in our vocabularies today, but the word is muse. The idea behind that word is to sit back, to meditate, to think. And we talked about the busyness of the season. We all have something going on probably today whenever we leave here. There's family obligations, there's some kind of practice, there's something going on, there's somewhere else that we will need to be, and it will be that way all week. There's busyness, there's plenty of stuff going on. And so while we may be busy, and all those things may be great and they could be necessary, we still should take some time during this season, during these next few weeks, to sit back, to meditate, and to think. To wonder. And all of this that is being said. To think that God would use Mary. That God would use Joseph. That God had already prepared this place in Bethlehem. He had already prophesied these things. And the Israelites were supposed to be looking forward to these days and anticipating these days. You know what the problem is? If you add an A to that word muse, you get the word amuse, and then, of course, we add meant to it, right? Amusement. That makes it a negative connotation. We've become so amused. We don't want to think. We don't want to sit back. We don't want to meditate. We want to go to the carnival. We want to go to the theme park. We want to be amused. And so because we are being amused, it takes away from that time of sitting back, meditating, and thinking. But here's something for us to think about. David Jeremiah put it this way. Here is the Ancient of Days becoming a baby in Bethlehem. This is what the people were wondering about. Here is the one who thunders in the heavens, crying in a cradle. Here is him that gives all their meat in due season, feeding at his mother's breast. Here is the one who made all flesh, now becoming flesh himself. Here is the one who could summon legions of angels wrapped in infants' clothing. Here is the mighty God, now a helpless child. Do you ever just stop and think about that? G. Campbell Morgan said, in the presence of such a holy miracle, there can be no fitting attitude of the human intellect save that of acceptance of the truth without any attempt to explain the mystery. One scholar said, I can scarce get past his cradle in my wondering to even wonder at his cross. He had never, up to this point, been bound by space, time, human form. He had never experienced pain, suffering, hunger, being tired, thirsty, any of those things. But he was willing to go through all of that and ultimately die so that you and I could experience peace. And so that you and I could experience eternal life. And so during this Christmas, how do we celebrate Christmas? Number one, by witnessing about Christ. Number two, by wondering at Christ. And then the third thing, by waiting before Christ. Because there's a word that's used in verse 19 that is even more intense than the word wonder. And it is the word ponder. In verse 19, it says, Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. It goes even deeper. Mary reflected on these things. She mused on these things. She pondered on these things. She saw how the shepherds responded. She heard about the angels and what they see. What we have to understand is that we can let the outward celebrations of this holiday take away from the one thing that can mean the most to us as Christians. And so we must make time for waiting before God. And then ultimately, how do we celebrate Christmas? As we open up presents, as we spend time with family, as we anticipate what Santa Claus may leave, we must worship Christ. When we're tearing that paper off, if you ever have watched the movie Christmas Story and seen the scene toward the end where the paper is everywhere and the parents are trying to figure out who's going to clean it up, that'll be our house Christmas morning. Anybody who wants to can come help clean up. It will be paper and boxes everywhere. But ultimately, as we unwrap those gifts, as we rip away the paper, as we tear open the boxes, we should be reminded of this point in history where it came to pass that it went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And because of that decree, we learn of the birth of our Savior in a little manger in Bethlehem. The shepherds returned, it says in verse 20, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told unto them. Christmas affords us a tremendous opportunity, numerous tremendous opportunities for glorifying God, for worshiping Christ. We do it as we sing our Christmas carols, when we pray personally, whenever we spend quiet time, even publicly as we worship together in church. We are to celebrate Christmas as Christians. In order to do that, it's going to require us to take a step back from the busyness of the season. It's going to require for us to spend some time wondering at Christ and waiting before Christ so that we can truly focus on Him. David Jeremiah talked about there was a year that he had been asked to preach in a church in Chicago, and it was during the Christmas season, and he was walking down the streets and they were playing the Christmas music and the lights were out and on all the businesses, and it was just a great scene. It was a pretty scene, and he was listening to the music and the words of the music, and he said, I just broke out in praise. He said, God, thank you that I'm alive during this particular time and that I was able to experience this and see these things. That's what it was like for the shepherds. They were alive during that time. They got to experience that. They got to see and go through what all we are just reading about. We cannot miss the importance and the significance of worshiping Christ as we celebrate Christmas. Let's close this way. It's told of a baby christening that was going to take place in a town in England. And it was a pretty prominent family, and everybody was coming in for the christening, and there was a housekeeper there who was taking everybody's coats, and there was a room, and they were just laying the coats, was the housekeeper, on this bed. And then later on, everybody began to ask, where's the baby? Where's the baby? We haven't seen the baby. Where's the baby? The housekeeper didn't know where the baby was. The mother and father didn't remember where the baby was. And finally, one of the guests said, I think I saw the baby in the bed that all the coats had been put on. By the time they got into the room where the baby was at, the coats had been laid on the baby and the baby had smothered to death. What is the irony here? Everybody there had forgotten the real purpose of the gathering. And the one to be honored had been murdered. I wonder if that isn't true for many of us this time of year. We forget the purpose of what Christmas is all about. Jesus is our celebration. He is the one to be honored, for He is our King. This year, will you honor Christ at Christmas by witnessing, wondering, waiting before Him, and ultimately worshiping Him? Let's pray. Lord, we come to you this morning.